Hello students, today we are going to study the origin of the English language. The name of the topic is the Indo-European family of languages. So, we will not only study the origin of this English language, we will also analyze the theories that prove its genealogy. The Indo-European languages are a family of several hundred related languages and dialects. English is classified genetically as a Low West Germanic language of the Indo-European family of languages. The early history of the Germanic language is based on reconstruction of a Proto-Germanic language that evolved into German, English, Dutch, Afrikaans, Yiddish, and the Scandinavian languages. The first account by a European to mention the ancient language Sanskrit came from Filippo Sassetti, a merchant who travelled to the Indian subcontinent. Writing in 1585, if you remember, he noted some word similarities between Sanskrit and Italian. Later, Sir William Jones, who was a very famous linguist and jurist, discovered an etymological connection between English and Sanskrit in 1783. Thomas Young first used the term Indo-European, which became the standard scientific term through the work of Franz Bopp. He did it in 1813. And from that time, the study of Indo-European family of languages has started taking place. If one compares a number of languages, it appears that some of them have some sort of relationship to one another, while others may seem quite isolated. Sometimes it seems certain that these languages must be branches from a common root. If some other qualities in the languages we are comparing corroborate the relationship and common ancestry, we may find ourselves well on the way to be able to construct a genealogy of our languages. In other words, to classify them into families. For example, if we take the words for is in some European and Asiatic languages, we may reconstruct with fair probability the ancestral prehistoric word from which all of these must have descended. Like Latin est, Greek esti, Sanskrit asti, Russian est, and German ist. English belongs in all its stages to the Indo-European family of languages. It was formerly called Indo-Germanic, and still earlier it was called Aryan or Aryan. It is pronounced in both ways, Aryan and Aryan. Indo-European is the name given to the set of linguistic forms from which nearly all European languages, as well as those of Persia and a very large part of India, can be proved to have descended. The Indo-European languages are a family of several hundred related languages and dialects. There are about 439 languages and dialects, according to the 2009 ethnologue estimate. About half of them, that is about 221, belong to the Indo-Aryan sub-branch. It includes most of the major current languages of Europe, the Iranian plateau, and the Indian subcontinent. In all these languages, Sanskrit, Iranian, Greek, Latin, Celtic, and Teutonic, we recognize the same root words for father, mother, brother, sister, God, man, and for the common needs and the common relations of life. The first account by a Western European to mention the ancient language Sanskrit came from Filippo Sassetti. He was born in Florence in 1540. He was a merchant who traveled to the Indian subcontinent. He wrote in 1585 and noted some word similarities between Sanskrit and Italian. These included words like deva or dio, which is god, sarpaha or serpe, which means serpent, then sapta or sete, meaning seven, asta or otto, which means eight, nava or nove, meaning nine. It was Thomas Young who in 1813 first used the term Indo-European. Then it became the standard scientific term through the work of Franz Bopp, whose systematic comparison of these and other old languages supported the theory. The term Indo-European is used because it merely suggests that the languages it comprises cover most of Europe and India, or that Europe and India mark the length of its confines. So, it is called Indo-European language. The predominance and pioneering position of the German philologists of the 19th century sufficiently accounts for the earlier term Indo-Germanic. The belief among the predecessors of the more scientific German philologists that Sanskrit was the ancestor of all the European and Asiatic languages may explain the use of the term Aryan for what we now call Indo-European. Beginning at some period several thousand years BC, this Indo-European language spread itself far and wide. As it spread with the changing needs of its speakers for different areas, it mixed with many Indo-European tongues. Thus, it was modified by them variously at different stages. As speakers spread farther and further from the starting point, their kinds of Indo-European language developed more and more qualities which made them different from their ancestor. There are eight main groups of Indo-European languages. These are all traceable back to the Indo-European primitive ancestor. These are divided into roughly an eastern and a western set of groups. They have in common certain basic changes from the original system, such as a general shift in the pronunciation of the guttural consonants g and k to a palatal position like s and sh. Thus, for example, the Indo-European assumed primitive form for the numeral 100 is kmtam, whereas languages of the western set of groups such as Latin retain the original k sound in kentam. Sanskrit has changed the k sound to sh sound and it became shatam. For this reason, the western languages are commonly referred to as kentam languages and the eastern as shatam languages. The eastern set comprises four groups of languages. They are Balto-Slavic, Indo-Iranian, Armenian and Albanian. The western groups are Greek, Latin, Celtic and Germanic. Balto-Slavic includes spoken languages of Baltic region, Lithuania and Latvia. Indo-Iranian includes Sanskrit type languages of Old and New India and Iran-Persia. Armenian and Albanian are spoken in relatively smaller areas of Caucasus region of Eurasia, but they are very distinctive. So, they have been given the position of two different languages. Greek is spoken in Greece. Latin is the language of Italy and its neighbors. Celtic survives in ancient inscriptions and in the languages of Wales, Ireland, etc. The Germanic group comprises the languages of Germany, Scandinavia, as well as English. It is only with the last, this Germanic group, that we are here concerned with. Indo-European is one of a number of families into which the world's languages may be divided. Also, it must be remembered that there are still many languages and even whole groups that have not been examined scientifically and hence cannot be fitted into any scheme of classification. We have to see what is it that makes this Germanic and therefore English Indo-European. Two outstanding characteristics indicate the Indo-Europeanness of a language: its structure and its vocabulary. Indo-European languages generally lend themselves in structure to parts of speech. A language may have inflections fully retained relatively from the original Indo-European, like Russian, or it may have lost most of its distinctive word endings, like modern English. English has reduced the inflections it once had to a minimum. It indicates the relationship of words in a sentence with only a minimum of change in their shapes or variations of endings. The languages where the inflections show the proper relationship of words in the sentence, the language is fairly free in the arrangement of words. Since in English, the relationship of words to each other is no longer made clear by their endings, this must be done in other ways. So, here the order of words is somewhat fixed. To make the meaning clear, it also uses prepositions and auxiliary verbs to take the place of the lost inflections. But as we think of its forms fairly readily as nouns, verbs, adjectives, etc., it is undoubtedly found to be Indo-European, because it is using parts of speech. Chinese, with its forms consisting not of parts of speech, but of what seem now to be merely monosyllabic roots, is therefore not Indo-European. Secondly, in the matter of vocabulary, the Indo-European languages have so much in common. They have a shared nucleus of fundamental roots that this common basis of vocabulary may serve to distinguish them from all other language groups. Thus, for instance, most of the names of family relationships, of elementary domestic materials, and of familiar animals can be seen to be shared by the Indo-European languages. Germanic, then, is Indo-European in the sense that it uses the parts of speech, and because, secondly, it shares a fundamental nucleus of the vocabulary of the commonest things with other Indo-European tongues. Probably in the millennium preceding the Christian era, there grew up in Northern Europe a type of Indo-European variety from which descended all those languages which are now known as Germanic. During the centuries immediately before Christ, the common Germanic collection of forms used among tribes of Northern Europe developed within itself separatist tendencies. With the progress of the migrations of its users into Western and Central Europe, there arose those historical languages from one section of which English is descended. The Western group has given us the languages of Germany, Holland, Belgium, etc. English belongs to this Western group. This Germanic had certain characteristics which distinguish it and all its developments from other Indo-European groups. The first characteristic is that there is a strong tendency to fix the stress of a word on its root syllable or as near as possible to its beginning. The second characteristic is the tendency to build up a two-tense system in the verb. In Indo-European, the stress was free, that is, it could be on different parts of the same word according to the context and meaning. But Germanic tendency was to put the stress near the beginning of the word. As we may hear every day from ordinary speech, the syllables at the end of a word in such a language as puts a strong stress at the beginning will tend to be first blurred in utterance and finally even lost completely. The syllables farthest away from this stress tend to become weak and later cease to be heard. It is this fixing of the stress near the beginning of a word in the Germanic languages that is the primary cause of the loss of inflections which has been so marked a characteristic of English. An outstanding feature of the Germanic verb is that it has properly only two tenses, a present and a past, which are indicated by the primary form of the verb, the other tenses being shown by means of auxiliary verbs and compound tenses. This extreme simplification of the verb in Germanic has fundamentally affected the character of the languages concerned. It resulted in a multiplying of compound tenses and in a great increase of flexibility of expression. According to Bede and the Anglo-Saxon Chronicle, the tribes which come to settle forcibly and overrun most of the Romanized Britain in the 5th and 6th centuries were from parts of Northern Germany. They were the Angles, Saxons and Jutes. These migrants brought with them what is called a Low German type of language, or rather one which was transplanted to England too early to be affected by the High German change of consonants which has made the distinction between the speakers of High German and those of Low German. The High German speakers are the Germans and the Austrians, and the Low German speakers are Dutch, Flemish and rural German dialects and English. Grimm's law or the first sound shift helps to explain the consonant changes from Indo-European to Germanic. The first change is from aspirated voiced stops to unaspirated voiced stops, which means bh, dh and gh became b, d and g. The next change, voiced stops became voiceless stops. B, D, G became P, T and K. The third change happened when voiceless stops became voiceless fricatives. For example, P, T, K became F, Th and X. A word like English better, which substantially retains today the root sounds it had among the Anglo-Saxons, became by the High German consonant shift the German besser, the other Low German dialects agreeing with English. Old English or Anglo-Saxon therefore belongs to the Low German subdivision of the Germanic group of languages. It is derived from dialects spoken by the Germanic invaders of Romanized Britain. Early English language was formally called Anglo-Saxon, but sometimes the term Old English also was used. The term Old English was used in early 13th century prose. The term Anglo-Saxon was never used of the language till the late 17th century. That too, it was used only in Latin. Scholars used to refer to the language as Saxon till the 18th century. The inhabitants were called Anglo-Saxons by the European writers to distinguish these English Saxon people from their own kinsmen who had remained in the German mainland. But King Alfred, who was first interested in English culture, called the general language of England Englisk, and its peoples also, whether they were Angles, Saxons or Jutes, he called them Englisk. The language of King Alfred is the indirect ancestor of the English of today, as it is written and spoken among the educated. The term Anglo-Saxon is not a synonym for English speaking, as many journalists and political writers nowadays are getting habituated to use. The term should be confined to the Germanic inhabitants of Britain before the Norman conquest and to their language. Language is a natural human growth. It never ceases to change. It experiences constant development and is in a constant stage of flux. Any division according to periods is artificial and approximate. Nevertheless, it is done to help in following the growth of languages. The history of English is divided into three main periods: Old English, Middle English and Modern English. English begins with Anglo-Saxon or Old English. It has developed many qualities of sound and syntax which differentiate it both from the original Common Germanic and from all other Germanic tongues. Naturally, Old English is distinguished by a number of special sound changes which separate it in varying degrees from the other related Low German languages. The Old English period extends from the earliest written documents about the close of the 7th century to about 1100. By this time, the effects of the Norman conquest began to be perceptible in the language. This language is characterized by a homogeneous Anglo-Saxon language with only a small amount of Latin influence, followed by some from Norse on the vocabulary of the written language. It is also characterized by having its inflectional system relatively full, with three or four case endings for its nouns and adjectives, and fuller verbal endings than existed at any time later. Its word order was relatively free, since its inflections prevented ambiguity. It had a number of dialects, but only one of them, the language of King Alfred, which was Wessex or West Saxon, had left literary monuments on any large scale. By the 10th century, this was the accepted language for most vernacular literary purposes. Even the literature of other dialects, such as most of the poetry, was recopied into the standard West Saxon, because with its local modifications, it had become a sort of common literary language all over the country. Middle English and Modern English are beyond the scope of today's discussion, as they are later developments in the already standardized English language. We will deal with them in a later class. One of the values of the study of the history of language is that it constantly reminds the student that language is by its nature fluid, never static. It is a living organism. So, students, here we finish our discussion of the Indo-European family of languages. I hope you understood it perfectly well. Thank you very much.